Christ is risen. Good Easter morning, First Christian Church, whether you are here with us in person or joining us online. We welcome you today, all of you, whoever you are. Please join our praise band in singing Happy Day and Because He Lives.
One, two, three, four.
There we go. Okay, now you can hear me. All right. Thank you for bearing with us, those of you online. This is our first Sunday worshiping in two spaces at once, and we're working out the kinks. Our call to worship this morning, your job is to simply answer, Christ is risen indeed. Out of the darkness of grief and despair comes a message of hope. Christ is risen. We run to the tomb to see for ourselves, and it is true, Christ is risen. We hear a voice call our name, and we know our risen Lord is with us now and always. Thanks be to God. So for our children's moment this morning, I need a little bit of help. We do have a couple kids in service here, and we have some at home as well. I was very confused this morning when I came downstairs. There was no tree in my family room and no presents underneath it. I left some cookies by the fireplace and those were uneaten, which was quite a surprise in my house. And in my state of puzzlement, I sat down on the couch and I sat on a plastic egg. Then later when I went to the closet to get my coat, another plastic egg fell down from somewhere unknown. And I'm terribly confused why there were no presents and no stockings, but eggs hidden everywhere. Can somebody tell me why I'm confused? Why? It's not Christmas, right? That's my confusion. It's not Christmas, it's Easter. But I guess why I'm confused is because on Christmas, Jesus was born, and on Easter, Jesus was born again. So what's the difference? Good question, huh? So I want you to hold on to that thought for a minute, and instead I want to talk about something else. I had a friend tell me yesterday that her son asked her where the name Easter came from. And I said, you know, I'll be honest, I don't know the answer to that. So I looked it up, and the name Easter comes from the pagan goddess Eos, I'm not quite sure how to say it, but the pagan goddess of the dawn. And the dawn means to rise, right? The sun is rising. The dawn represents a new day. It represents a new birth of a new day and new hope and new prospects. And especially in the springtime, the reason that the pagans celebrated the goddess of the dawn is because the spring is when we experience a rebirth of our world, right? The plants all start to grow again. Animals are having babies. It's a whole rebirth of our planet. And it brings new life and new food and new hope. So come back to that question I asked you. What's the difference between Christmas and Easter? At Christmas, we're celebrating the birth of Jesus, and we're celebrating that promise of hope and that promise of love that Jesus is going to come and teach and share with our world. But at Easter, we're celebrating his rebirth, his return. It's a second chance. It's a chance to start again. So that's, to me, the difference between Christmas and Easter, is that Easter, yeah, we're celebrating hope and love to come, or excuse me, at Christmas, we're celebrating the hope and love to come, but at Easter, we're celebrating a second chance. And for us, that second chance is so important, because we never got to meet Jesus, we never got to hear his teachings, but we have a second chance every day to wake up and start anew and be our best self and help our world become its best world because of that promise of Easter and that promise of rebirth and a second chance. So I want you to think about that when you go on your Easter egg hunts today, but that's the difference between Christmas and Easter, not just presents versus chocolate eggs, but it's love and hope versus a second chance to start again and renew that love and hope. Now we're going to have our stewardship moment.
Thank you, Carin. That kind of leads right into the verse I found to read today, from Philippians 4, verse 19. Paul wrote this, "My God shall supply all your need according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus." And yes, he did. He provided everything we need through Christ and his rebirth and our second chance. And so, just some thoughts here in ways that we can go about showing appreciation for that, I guess. And one question is, how can I answer the prayer of a neighbor today? And we are God's hands and feet. And so to do God's work, that's one thing we can do. How can I answer the prayer of a neighbor today? And also, how will I plant a seed of God's love today? Another thing we can do, very subtle, very quiet, but very important. And so, and another thing that we can do, of course, this is the stewardship moment. We can give of our resources. And so if you are here today, there is an offering plate out in the hallway where you can place your offering if you would like. You can go online at lansingdisciples.org, and there's a donate button, and you can donate online that way. Or you can answer the prayer of a neighbor today. You can plant the seed of God's love today. And with those thoughts in mind, let's continue with the service. Thank you.
Our scripture this morning comes from Luke chapter 24, verses 1 through 12. But on the first day of the week, at early dawn, they went to the tomb, taking the spices which they had prepared. And they found the stone rolled away from the tomb. But when they went in, they did not find the body. While they were perplexed about this, behold, two men stood by them in dazzling apparel. And as they were frightened and bowed their heads to the ground, the men said to them, "Why do you seek the living among the dead? Remember how he told you while he was still in Galilee that the Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men and be crucified, and on the third day rise." And they remembered his words, and returning from the tomb, they told all this to the 11 and to all the rest. Now it was Mary Magdalene and Joanna and Mary, the mother of James, and the other women with them who told this to the apostles. But these words seemed to them an idle tale, and they did not believe them.
Truly, may God bless the hearing of his holy word this day. And I don't know if you noticed, but my sermon title today was Insider Knowledge. And it kind of fits what you were saying, Carin. But that being said, before we begin to unpack all this, this Easter Sunday, which is a joyous Sunday, let us go to God in prayer. Will you pray with me? God, unlimited by mortal fear, our tomb's cold grip. In the lingering dark, give us grace to know your life triumphant, your portion undimmed in the face of Jesus Christ. Now may the words of our mouths and the thoughts that we form as one be pleasing in your sight, for we ask it through Jesus Christ, the resurrection and the life. I want you to do something. We've already done it many times this morning, but would you participate with me in this and respond to each little thing I give you this morning? Christ is risen. Christ is risen. One more time. Christ is risen. All right. I like it. I love it. Truly, Resurrection Sunday, this Sunday, Easter Sunday, is God's final word spoken in the face of sin, suffering, and evil and death. Amen. Thanks be to God. Amen. 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 Yes, on this Sunday of celebration, we are moving with God. We are moving with God in that we are finding a new way to deal with life's challenges and live a life that God is filled with in that. And then today, we move with insider knowledge, and that's a really important thing. We move with insider knowledge of what's going on. And you know, this always reminds the pastor of a story, and this one happens to be one of a bank. You're going to say, what does money have to do with? Well, nothing, nothing. But a bank was in Birmingham, New York. Well, they had some people that were their, competitors, and they wanted to send them flowers, so they did. Because their bank had expanded, and they were in a new building. However, when they received this flower arrangement, the card on it read something unique. It said, "With deepest sympathy." Not good, right? The florist, I've got to admit, was embarrassed beyond compare. and couldn't imagine how the mix-up had happened between that. And he apologized so completely. I hope you're getting the picture now. It wasn't until that afternoon, later that afternoon, that the florist kind of, I didn't want to say, sat up with a horrified look on the florist's face. You can about imagine about this time. When he realized there's a funeral somewhere, and somebody's opening a card, right? And it says, congratulations on your new location. Think about that. So on that first Easter morning, over 2,000 years ago, at the crack of dawn, we find Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Mary, the mother of James, and as it says, the other women. And they approached the tomb. And, you know, they weren't looking for a new location or to move on. I mean, sure, we can relate, can't we? I mean, when we think about our days, we really don't think about moving on, especially this time with COVID-19 and all going on. I mean, the dead and the dying don't move on, do they? Because, you know, they were really experiencing something unique. They were experiencing the grief and the devastation of Good Friday and Holy Saturday. As they walked, they didn't anticipate anything changed. They were bringing spice and they were bringing oils to anoint the body of the dead, that is the dead body of the Savior. Truly, they were stuck. They were stuck in a world kind of like today, right? Proclaiming a message like the card, our deepest sympathy. I mean, those who opposed Jesus, the Romans and those priests and Sadducees of the temple, worked hard to stop his words and to silence his message. What they saw, and if you think about this, what they saw was a man who sparked a movement against Rome and against those in the temple who had easy jobs, you might say. I mean, they did put a temple tax on top of the Roman tax on everything else, and it requested everyone to do more than they themselves would do. Yes, they saw a man whose ministry moved throughout the country of Capernaum and Samaria and Jerusalem and even our Galilee, a person of power and authority that they've never met before, and they knew they needed to stop that movement. But what they didn't know, and what we celebrate today, what they didn't know was that even death couldn't stop Jesus, who is God on the move among us. Now, I want you to remember that, God in the move among us. So the women who walked the way, all the way to the tomb of Jesus, what did they see? They saw this large round stone had been moved. Now, I want to tell you, that's not an easy thing to do, because generally, not only would they use a large stone, but it was also, they dug a little divot, if you will. It's kind of like me playing golf, dug a little divot. And they rolled this stone in, and so it'd take a lot of people to move it. But they saw more. They saw that more that morning. They saw the stone. And for once in their life, they saw a world that had changed, even though they didn't know it yet. I mean, they really didn't know yet. No, they expected to encounter and was the continuing message of sympathy and of grief that had begun on Friday and Saturday. But instead, they found Sunday's message of congregations and a Savior who was not to be contained in one location, but who was God on the move among us. They found this, as Luke tells us in the 24th chapter. Two men beside them in gleaming bright clothing. Now, I want you to imagine what it was like. I mean, back in those days in the first century, to have two people show up in gleaming white clothing. Now, that was a sign of God being there. So what did they do? What did they do? With a sudden change. I mean, they expected to see Jesus laying on a slab. Instead, they see two men in bright clothing. What do? They're afraid. They're very much afraid. In fact, the scripture tells us this. The women were frightened. They bowed their faces toward the ground. And the men said to them, "Why are you looking for the living among the dead?" And it goes on to say, "He isn't here. He's been raised." Quite a change, don't you think? I mean, when you think about everything, they didn't expect it. Yes, Jesus was out of the tomb. Jesus was out of the tomb and was on the move again to do more. Just as he'd done in his other life, his life itself, to bring healing to brokenness and newness of life. And he did this fresh and new. He did this as throughout his normal ministry, his earlier ministry, when he encountered the painfully broken or the world that was not friendly to them. And he reversed everything. Yes, Jesus did heal sickness and heal people when he found them. If we look at Luke 4, it talks about a time when Jesus was in Capernaum. He was teaching. There was a man who was demon-possessed. And he asked Jesus, the demon yelled out, "What do you have to do with us?" And what did Jesus do? He spoke harshly to him. We find this in the 35th verse in that fourth chapter. He says, "Come out! Come out!" And the demon threw him down. But the beautiful thing about this is Jesus made sure he was not harmed. It says this, and he came out of him without harming him. So what happened? I mean, one person's healed, but what happened? Well, scripture tells us this. When the sun came down, everyone brought Jesus, their relatives, and their acquaintances with all kinds of diseases. Placing his hands on them, he healed them. He healed them. More. Jesus did a lot more than that. I mean, when he found people that were hungry, he fed them. Remember the story of the 5,000? It's a great story. It's not a story, actually, but it's a truth. He told the disciples to let the people sit down because there was green grass everywhere and it was a great place to sit. And there was plenty for them. Now that's 5,000, but you have to understand, we're only talking about men. It didn't say about women, or they didn't say about kids. They just talked about women. But then Jesus told them to have them sit down. And it says this, it says, "Then Jesus took the bread and he blessed it and gave thanks and he distributed it to them sitting there. And he did the same with the fish. Each one got what they wanted." Now, depending upon the gospel that you read, you may have also noticed that sometimes they say that up to 12 baskets were collected. That's an amazing, amazing thing. And where he found sin and death, he brought forgiveness and resurrection. We all know the story of Lazarus, though. And you know, the thing that always struck me about Lazarus was this. First of all, he speaks to God in a prayer, and God responds to him. But he says this, "I say that for the benefit of the crowd standing here, so that they will believe that you sent me." Having said this, Jesus said in a loud voice, "Lazarus, come out." Now, we know what happened then. Lazarus did come out. And he tells them to untie him and go. What a great, great thing. Jesus did this. But for the women who came that day to the tomb, it was as it was for the apostles who didn't expect the resurrection, even though they've been told about it. What was important for them, or what they needed to know, was that Jesus was strong enough to reverse the brokenness, even the brokenness that the world had inflicted upon him. I mean, they had already encountered stories of resurrection. Perhaps you've read them or heard of them. Enoch, you know, I don't know about you, but he's only mentioned three times, but Enoch, Elijah taken up in a whirlwind, and then there was Lazarus. But no one had resurrected themselves. But the two in white told women this had happened. What I found interesting in this whole scripture is that when the women went back to the disciples, their words struck them as being nonsense. And they didn't believe the women. Not even James believing his mother. Even when Peter ran to the tomb, he saw only the linen cloth and returned, as the scripture says, wondering. He didn't understand. So for me, it's no accident that in Luke, there's another story. Do you know what the story is? The story is the road to Emmaus. Immediately following, it says the resurrection on the same day. God was always in the business of stopping evil and, you know, bringing wholeness and defying death. And this is the ultimate occasion to prove just exactly what he was doing. So on that same day, we find Jesus walking on that road to Emmaus that's like 7 miles from Jerusalem. Here are two disciples, Cleopas and another one, which is not named, are broken. They're suffering. The events of Jesus' death has just put them beside themselves. They don't recognize him. Now you might say, why don't they recognize him? Well, you know, he went through a lot. So, but they don't recognize him. So they think they're going home to lick their sores, if you will, their wounds and the sadness and grief. But Jesus shows them and has a different idea. Jesus teaches them all about what was to happen to him. In other words, he was telling them exactly what he had told his disciples. And scripture tells us that they opened up the scriptures to them. And when Jesus looked like he was going to go on to another place further down the road, they invited him to stay the night and to have bread with them, to break bread with them. But you know, Jesus did something very unique. He did things backward because they should have been the ones blessing the food and handing it out. But instead, Jesus went to the table, he blessed the bread, broke it, and this is where it kind of gets exciting because he disappeared from their sight. Jesus was on the move again. He'd healed these two that had been grieving so much. He healed their pain. So the two in the scriptures tell us that they were gone because the fire in their hearts was so great. And they went back to the Jerusalem and they went to the apostles then. And they shared the news with the 11 that were there. And this is just the first instance of the empty tomb and the rolling away of the stone and the chains of death being moved. So how great an idea is that? I mean, how great an idea is that? Even the tomb could not hold Jesus. I mean, when evil thinks they've stopped him, he's on the road again. Even for us today. That's something we have to remember. He's on the road again, even for us today. So today, with our insider knowledge, if you will, the fact we can read the Bible, there is more than just remembering, just celebrating on this Easter Sunday, for Jesus is on the move even today and in us. Yes, whenever we're feeling sick or stuck or trapped, when our pasts, think about it a minute, when our pasts tell us that we are not worthy or never will change. Whenever we encounter a world that seems to be lost in grief and pain, and believe me, this last year has been that way, we find a moving Savior that heals us. A Savior who gives us strength to be God's image in here and now. You might say, how's that? Well, it could be excitement on Easter Sunday. It could be the fact that we look upon each other, and when we see somebody who's not fed or is not clothed, we make sure they are. It could be a lot of things. Or when people are discriminated against, we make sure that they're not. So today is a day of celebration for God's people, us, for new locations and second chances and new hopes and dreams. Why? Why? Because death tried to stop Jesus and didn't succeed. Yes, Jesus is alive and moving in this world each day in our lives today in new ways. And we're invited to move with him. Christ is risen. Christ is risen. Hallelujah. Let us pray. Most gracious Lord, as we gather this day, we want to give thanks for this time that we can gather together in this space we call holy. We give thanks for the Christ who is raised, who brings healing each day to us through the assurance that nothing, nothing can stop you. We give thanks for the power that he gives us that we might look upon each other and enliven each other with the same joy that we have to take care of those who cannot take care of themselves, to be with those who are oppressed. Lord, we give thanks for this day because it is this day that puts an exclamation point and yet a beginning of a new ministry through us and the Holy Spirit. Amen. We do make an invitation at this time and this day that if you've not accepted Christ in your life, and of course we know that there are many online that cannot do this, but if you are someone who's found Christ in a new way in their lives, would like to be part of this congregation, if you would like to make confession of faith and join in this walk together, I would ask you to do so this day and come forward to do so as we hear our hymn of invitation, O Happy Day.
Paul, you need to unmute the mic, please.
All right. Boy, I tell you what, forgive us, we're trying to learn this new system. But if you find that you have somebody that you like to lift up today, I'm going to give you a time that you can just lift their voice or your voice up and name them by name. So let us prepare and let us pray as one. Oh God, as we've gathered this day, like the first witnesses of the resurrection, we too come to the empty tomb with a variety of responses of grief and despair and anxiety. Yet we hear the good news that Jesus has risen, but as often the evidence for this is difficult to detect in our lives. And more, Lord, in the chaos that we find in our world. We pray that you would renew our faith and help us to make the risen Christ evident through our words and our actions. Yes, help us to believe and do that we may see, that others may see, and then believe. So, Lord, in this day, we come to the empty tomb of Jesus and gaze in. In this, help us to remember that not only is his tomb empty, but Jesus is both with you and here and those who believe. Holy One, we pray this day that your resurrection power may surround and embrace those who grieve today. So we raise before you this day those who are utmost in our hearts and minds and our voices, knowing you always hear us. We pray this day for Doug and Pam as they've gone to family. Their daughter-in-law, Laura, is going to have heart surgery this week, and we pray for the well-being of their daughter, as well as the skills of the doctors who see to her. We also pray for Doug's brothers, Larry and Wayne, for their health and their fight against cancer. Carin and Jim both asked for a friend who's taking chemo for healing and strength for her and her family. But in the same way, Lord, we also pray for those in our community as well as throughout the world who are facing this dreaded disease, this COVID-19, which has afflicted so many, and with our numbers growing by leaps and bounds each day, even with our vaccines. We also pray for those in this world that are facing times of trouble, and it seems as to be the norm today. There's a chaos which is beyond our understanding. Now, Lord, we lift our voices to you for others that are on our minds and hearts. These things we ask through Jesus Christ, our resurrected Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, who taught his disciples and us to pray. Our Creator, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. You know, we come to the table, and it is this time, again, where we lift our voices to God and we remember his oneness with us. So today, as we gather around the table, let's be honest, the Last Supper finally makes sense. We see the power of Jesus' sacrifice confirmed in Jesus' victory over death. And in this, not in a meaning, if he had only declared himself as a sacrifice and he died this table still would not make sense. Easter would not make sense. No, the empty tomb would not make sense. We celebrate around this table to remember the sacrifice which led to the victory over death. As Paul the Apostle reminds us in 1 Corinthians, the last enemy to be put under his feet was death. Today, at this table, we remember and celebrate that ultimate victory. So come, eat, drink, and remember Christ and what he's done for you. For all are invited. For on the night that Jesus was betrayed, he took the loaf and he lifted it to God. And upon doing so, he broke it and blessed it. And he gave it to all of his disciples and said, take, eat, for this is my body given for you. In the same way, after the supper, he took the cup and he filled it with wine and he gave it to all of his disciples. And he told them they all should drink deeply of it. For within it, they would find the new covenant for the remission of many sins. As long as they ate of this bread and they drank the cup, they proclaimed his death until he came again.
Let's pray. Lord, as we take this bread, we remember that you are the bread of life. You feed our souls, nourish our hearts, and give us sustenance to meet the challenges before us. As we break the bread, we feel the softness like the fragrance of the bread. We experience your grace afresh each day. We thank you with all our hearts for the great price you paid when you were crucified on the cross for us. Yet, just as the yeast has caused this bread to rise, you rose again, triumphant over death as the Lord of Lords and our Savior forever. Amen.
Before the prayer, I'd just like to say, as this is Women's Month, of course it was women who went to the tomb. Thank you, gentlemen. I hope you heard that. I want you just to quiet your minds, still your heart. Don't think about work tomorrow or dinner today. And just think upon these words that I have to say. And I ask that the words not come from me, but be inspired by a higher power. Yes, Lord, just be with us right now. As we think about the fact that Jesus made a promise, it was a covenant. He said that he would rise, he would live, and so he lives. When we come to the table, when we partake of the bread and the juice of the grape, we often are solemn. But I ask that you not be solemn, for he is risen, and it was his death and his resurrection that made Friday, the Friday of his death, Good Friday. So we just thank you, Lord, for the Good Friday. Lord, we thank you for the bread that stands for his broken bones. We thank you for this juice of the grape that stands for his blood, that gives us the promise of eternal life, should we believe. So I ask you on this day that you just give praise and you come to the table or you take the bread and the wine with happiness, knowing that you have, as believers, the promise of eternal life. Amen. So let us be happy. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen.
Amen. So as you have received your cups and coming in, I would ask you to first take the bread and then the cup and remember. But also during this time, as we hear the music played, if you would like to come forward and take a carnation and place it on our tree of life, if you will, our cross of life, I would ask you to also do that this day.
Thank you.
Oh, this has been a fantastic day, a good start. But as we prepare to leave this place, I would ask those who come today, and I know we all want to be mindful of the COVID-19, that when you're ready to leave, please go down the hallway and gather in the parking lot where we will join together in conversation at a distance, obviously, and a blessing. Now, receive the benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift the Lord's countenance upon you and give you peace, not only this Easter Sunday, but all the days to come. Amen. Let us...
I know that this year of isolation has been difficult, and those of us who've been able to join together today, we're so blessed to be able to do that. And for those that are at home, they just want to have the opportunity to be in this space together with us. So in a moment, I'm going to pull the webcam and turn it around and give all of our congregation at home the opportunity to see your faces the way I am. So if you do not desire to be on our Facebook stream today, please go ahead and exit the sanctuary now. And at the end of the song, if you do not wish to be on our Facebook stream, go ahead and exit the sanctuary. But otherwise, please remain for just a moment so that we can share all of our Easter faces with all of our families at home. Thank you.
And well, let's join together at our closing hymn, My Redeemer Lives, with the praise band.